Several times a week, we would have questions about end-of-life questions, literally several times a week. I must have come through several hundred such questions with my grandfather. Almost everybody who had a child came to my grandfather with these questions. So it was from around the world.
And what was his position when someone came in and said that?
My grandfather's position about termination of life was, of course, each case was individualistic, but there are certain basic rules. One rule was that he considered a ventilator, a respirator, as a possible curative factor, not just as a prevention of death. And unlike the discussion in the Shulchan Aruch of a hakos kardim, of bringing in a nak or salt that just prevents death, he was concerned that maybe this is more than just prevention of death, and maybe somewhat contributory in a positive sense to life. Though there are people, and he was cognizant, who held differently. There was a tshuva from somebody up north in Israel, my grandfather felt was a very precise, I don't recall the fellow's name now, not a well-known posek in Israel, but his position on this was very clear and thoughtful, which he said is exactly the same discussion as menias, as prevention of death. Grandfather said it's a logical approach, but it's not definitive, and thus we have to take the other approach. Being that it possibly is contributory to life, not just prevention of death, he felt once a person was on a ventilator, respirator, he cannot be arbitrarily removed from it. What he did say was that when the person has to be removed for, he used to call it for suctioning, what that still is relevant, I'm not sure, but at the time it was a medical procedure, that every X number of hours they had to take out the tube to suction out the lungs. At that stage, you don't reinsert it until you've ascertained that there's still neurological function. That was his referred to in the Chavis as waiting 10 minutes, 15 minutes, seeing if there's any independent respiration going on. If there is no independent respiration, then do not return it. If there is, of course, you put it back in. He also sometimes would recommend, if given the prerogative, to place it on a finite oxygen supply, not to plug it into the hospital supply, so that when the tank ran out, again, you had a chance to ascertain whether the patient was or wasn't really halakhically alive or imperatively associated with the respirator. That's so far as removing the respirator. And so far as whether or not the respirator should be placed in the first place, he had several criteria. The first was chayisha im yisurim ein marichin, that if the patient's in torturous pain, you do not extend that person's life artificially. And the source for that is the Gemara Baruchin Betradion. And that's one of my grandfather's fundamental principles in medical ethics, that you do not extend life chayishah, it's only temporary life. I mean, you cannot gain at least a year of life. If the person's to be tortured, to substantial torture, similar to be burnt alive, you don't extend that person's life artificially. The other principle he had was you let it gamble chayishah in order to engage the possibility of chai normali, chai olam, but it means regular lifespan, so that if a person has a finite life, based on the best of medical evidence, he could only live up to a year, and they're contemplating some procedure which would permit you to cure the person, and then whatever he'll live, maybe as an older person, live a short period of time anyway, if statistically it was within a viable possibility, and didn't require too much, even a minority possibility, let's say, 10%, 15% chance of success, without a gamble, a guarantee, 4 months of life for a chance of getting 3 years of life. And that would impact upon whether or not you place the person in a respirator or go for something more aggressive. Those are the two principles which he tended to use. And then perhaps the third principle was that we do not differentiate quality of life as a factor in defining if a person should live or shouldn't live. That even a vegetative life shouldn't happen to anybody. It deserves all the consideration of the halacha, all the consideration of the ethical and moral message of the Torah. And you don't say, short of a person giving a living will, which is another discussion, if we had to assess it ourselves, we do not differentiate. My father refers to that in his lectures as the slippery slope of medical ethics, and if you start differentiating and defining who does and who doesn't deserve to live. And my grandfather, though he wasn't quite enthused with this idea of a slippery slope, did acknowledge the veracity of not differentiating.